Hello, everybody. Welcome to Cause and Effect, a show about Vetus. Today we're going to talk about the card Floor of Action, a card that made somewhat of a comeback these last years in deck building. That's our point of view, anyway. And then later on in the show, Isak and Adam are going to give you their best draft tips. But first, as always, I would like to introduce my two wonderful co-hostess. Adam Esbjörnsson, say hello.
Hello.
And Isak Esbjörnsson Bjärmark, say hello.
Hello.
How lovely to see you too. So, Adam, how has your Vetus week been?
It's been fine. Had a regular Wednesday night Vetus game. Got to play tryout, I should say. Funny new deck idea with Cavalier and Madness Quill. It didn't work that well because the deck was 75 card, but after that, those games, I slimmed it to 60 cards, so I'm still hopeful.
So, Bo, what's the... How does it work? Why do you want to untap with the Melkaus?
Oh, I'll use Lutz and Maurice Streck and Rachel Brandwine and Boat as well.
Okay. Yeah, seems legit.
So basically you're power bleeding with multi-act.
Yeah.
Reinventing that much?
No, it's like I'm just the more roundabout way you're playing an Erika deck.
Yeah, that's what I thought.
Yes.
I always wanted to have Lutz get fortitude.
Yes. Like from the get-go. I think that's like the true holy grail on Vetus. Lutz with multi-act or Lutz with fortitude.
Lutz and Erika should get children.
Yes.
And make those children 11 cap with plus...
22 cap.
But they wouldn't be 11 cap.
22 cap.
They would be 10 cap. I think that's how it works.
Yeah, but you only make... You don't need two vampire parents. You only have one.
Huh.
You can use the two and then you become a caitiff, right?
They never mix.
Okay.
they're like the Tigerians.
I had a good Vetus week anyway. How about someone else?
Isak, how was your Vetus week?
It's been nice. I played one game during the pub game. Got my ass handed to me by a newbie. But he did it with my deck, so felt a little bit better. But yeah, and I've been designing a draft set for like a custom-made draft set for the Swedish National Championship.
Oh, cool.
So it's going to be a unique draft event at the Nationals.
Next week.
Okay. Do you have a spoiler? What will the set theme be?
The set theme is independent.
Okay.
Oh,
so it's the four major independent clan plus Gangrel, which by rulebook is independent, and also some Abominations and some Edi.
Okay, I'm excited anyway.
Funny stuff. Yeah, I'm excited as well. This will be awesome.
And you,
Anders?
Yeah, I've played some up here in Sundsvall. It's been a lot of fun. We actually have a good game going on here, and it's and I'm out of work, so I need to get out of the house. So I go and play, and it's been fun. Been playing some Wargul deck. And remember the effect, the burn your Wargul to burn a location, so I managed to win a game, which was awesome for me.
Which card text? You read the card text?
Yeah, I read the card text.
That's good.
That's good. It's especially important if that one location that you're having a headache over is Secure Haven.
Yeah.
Or which you say.
Yeah. Kind of important.
Isn't it the case that the card text pretty much is tap Wargul to burn Secure Haven? Or?
Could be.
But if you face a club zombie, the only...
Yeah, if you face a club zombie, then you could probably just... I don't know. Take your own life.
Yeah. Just shoot fish in a barrel.
Yeah. That's not a good card. I just want to get that out there. It's an expensive card.
Yeah, it is. Very expensive. 4 pool. Yeah. It's not an expensive eBay, I would think. Maybe a dollar. or so.
We should buy everyone.
And then when we have all the club zombies in the world, we can sell them for a really high price.
Supply and demand.
Genius.
Oh, but that's economics for you.
Yeah. So.
I know this.
So, let's move on. We're going to talk about a card that supplies both supply and demand, you could say. Flora of Action. Because you can make demands and then make supplies if you manage to bleed.
That yeah, but it's very hard if your opponent has many Mariners.
Yes. We make expand and then we defend. Anyway, so Adam, what's your first take on the Flora of Action as a card?
I can tell you my first reaction, like when I saw it when it was released, and it was pretty much, wow, this card is like really good. Now the Azumites can multi-act. That was my reaction.
Oh,
because at that time I actually had Azumite decks in plural. But yeah, well. The point still stands, but it's not the Azumites that gains the most from it, obviously. But it's really, really good, the superior effect to untap. And the inferior effect is mostly for flavor, but in some cases it's going to be like, okay, I need to draw this, I don't know, Reigns of Power. I'm going to play Flare of Action as inferior, and then you get a chance for a game win. But most of the time, it's like the superior that's the strong effect.
So, a rule question about the inferior effect. You get to draw when the bleed is successful, so you can't draw for bleed modifiers, or...?
No, you can't. Well, you can draw freak drives, right? You could have drawn a freak drive from that and play a freak drive afterward.
Yeah, because that says after the action, blah blah blah.
Yeah.
But no conditionings, I'm sorry.
So if you play the Fury of Action Freak Dive deck, it's possible. But probably you're not going to play that deck.
I think I played with that once. So.
Okay.
Fury Action Freak Dive?
Yeah.
Strong?
No. It was an Ishtari deck, I believe. Not that strong.
No.
So, Isaac, what's your... take on it? Do you have anything to add?
I've been very skeptical of this card from the get-go, and I more or less still am. I'm starting to get persuaded by different games I have gotten my ass handed to me. So more and more I'm starting to think that this card is actually very, very good. But it's, in my opinion, it's, you need to find these very, because there's a lot of different things that needs to align to the for the card to be useful. It's not like a conditioning or a govern or freak or some card like that that more or less always adds something when you add it to deck. This deck you have to add with a lot of more thought to it, to your deck.
Yeah, you can't just splash it in and hope that it works by itself, because you have to.
Yeah, you have to find some high cap, probably. You want some stealth disciplines, you want to have a second action that is good enough to do this inferior bleed rather than have some bleed card like Govern or Intimidation or Public Thrust or something like that. Yeah. I said Public Thrust. It's called Public Thrust. So you really have to think a lot about it and make it stick to the right deck to actually use it.
Yeah. My first impression was I was really, really excited about this card when I found out about it, and I thought I had some long and hard thoughts of making a Celerity mono deck with this card and just guns and Flurry of Action, but that just sucked balls. It's not the way to go with this card, for me anyway. Thoughts?
I actually. Around that time, I built the decklist of a Obfuscate Auspex Celerity deck, which was Weenie Auspex. Well, not Weenie Auspex, obviously, because I had those disciplines, but it was like an Auspex deck which get the Pulse of the Canal and use the Prayer of Action to bleed. Just as a tangent to your deck idea.
Yeah.
I was not that good at this game at that point.
Well, both your deck ideas seems a little bit... weak.
Yeah, but we were...
Don't be too judgmental.
Yeah, but I think around that time we didn't understand the power of the high caps. We were a lot of mid caps that were the shit back then.
On the other hand, there were no power of the mid or the high caps until they released Villain. So.
Well, it both well the deck ideas kind of illustrates something that I think that's more or less needed with the flare of action, and Isaac talked about it, and that's the need for a second action.
Yeah.
It actually just can't just like, okay, I'm gonna add this and then hope things work out for the best, or I'm gonna add this untap and then stay untapped to wait to block. It's really, really inefficient. But on the flip side,
swear.
It's a legitimate exposure, come on.
Okay.
You can't include only Flare of Actions and then only vote cards, I don't think. Because the Flare of Action is actually kind of weak. That bleed that you do is a really bad bleed.
Yeah.
And you can't... Well, the votes will need to be, like, come to your hand at the most opportune times. You need a really good card flow and whatnot to make a Flare of Action and vote kind of deck work out. And since most decks that are high caps will want to include, say, Intimidation or Mind Rapes or some other strong action that already has plus bleed at some level, those cards are going to be dead if your idea is to play Flare of Action every single turn with all your minions.
Yeah.
So it's better to include some bleed actions, some Flare of Actions, and some vote cards, and just try to mix them in the best possible way every single turn, depending on what your opponent is doing. And it might be a bit convoluted, but I think we'll get together when we start talking about decks.
But what you're trying to say is Flare of Action is such a weak bleed action that you can't only rely on it to be able to win.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay.
Because the vote cards are not good enough.
Yeah. Isaac, anything more before we...
That's more or less where I'm standing as well. Yeah. So...
But I just want to say it's a card to get your mind juices flowing because you get some opportunities with it, which I think is great. Anywho, we have the first deck that we are going to analyze that uses Flare of Action, which is an Inner Circle deck. Adam.
I think I got it. Yes, I got it. Yep. So what we're looking at here is a deck from 2010 by Benoit Moyen, which it won a 34-player tournament. And it's more or less like the new Inner Circles, the ones that has Celerity and Obfuscate, but also some of them have Dominate and Presence. So like the common denominator is Celerity, Obfuscate, but Dominate and Presence are really good as well on the Inner Circles. And then it's just Flare of Action with other really powerful actions in combination.
Okay. When I look at this crypt, there's three Mistress Fanchon, and her special is really good with this deck.
Yeah, it really is, because the one issue that we talked about earlier with having something to do after you do Flare of Action, you always have something to do with Mistress Fanchon, because you can go get Ankle Cog, you can go get a Bounce, you can go get a Banishment, you can go get... you can't go get any Masters, obviously, but there's a lot of really strong high cap votes, possibly even Mind Rapes. I don't think they're included in this particular deck, but you could include them. So there's a lot of different options when it comes to using that second action of the Flurry of Action.
Yeah. So are there any other key cards or mechanics in this deck, Adam?
Not this deck specifically. Well, the crypt is kind of interesting because the crypt is really, really good. It's not just the three Inner Circles. Oh, sorry, I'm gonna bring up the deck. The three Inner Circles, which are obviously really good with the Flare of Action, because they have three bleed basic. But also, you see Tamari, he has Celerity, Dominate, Obfuscate, and Plus Bleed. And Susan Kadim has Celerity, Dominate, Obfuscate as well with Plus Bleed. And that's just like, what? There are five vampires with this Whispered and Plus Bleed? It's, well, before searching your decklist application, you wouldn't have thought that was the case, because it's kind of a wonky discipline combination. So the crypt is actually really good, and that's a bit surprising.
The funny thing is that, I don't know if he forgot or elected not to play, you can play Helena base. She's got the same disciplines and plus bleed as well, and groups with this. So there are even one more vampire that you can include that has plus bleed and these disciplines.
Is she red list or something? Or is there some other?
Not base. Base is the Toreador. But this, I will say this, this might be obvious, but this is a high cap deck, so you play, do the usual thing. If you don't start with any Crypt Acceleration on your hand, start discarding immediately, play your Crypt Acceleration, get a guy up, do villain, get next guy up, do villain. So you need to have that basic high cap Crypt Acceleration villain engine going on. And then you have this other stuff when you if you start to play it, that is.
How many Flurry of Action? Are there 8 Flurry of Action cards in this?
In 65, which is huge.
Yeah.
It's a lot.
They're just like the only action card, and then there's political actions. That's it.
Yeah.
I think this deck relies heavily on Enkelkog. I think almost every single time you're going to Cryptax Mistress first, and then Flare of Action Bleed, take her action for getting Enkelkog, and then the next turn you're gonna bleed with her twice every single turn or every single round.
Okay.
If someone else were to play Enkelkog, I don't think this many Flare of Actions would be as good.
Yeah.
If someone else plays Enkelkog and you get to contest it, that amount of Flare of Action is actually kind of detrimental. But it could be a meta choice.
I would, as we talked about a little bit earlier, I would mix them up with some other cards.
Well, a few Mind Rapes wouldn't be bad, but I also see that playing a deck like this, there are quite few cards that cost blood, actually, so you can be laying quite hard. Since Flare of Action and Flare of Action and Political Actions, they don't cost anything base.
Yeah.
So you get around really cheaply with your vampires, and that's actually that could easily translate to one extra minion late game.
Yeah,
since you get to be lane harder.
Okay, how crypt wise, how important is it that the vampires have a plus one bleed or more?
I think it's really, really important because since Flare of Action is a very weak bleed action. Like, it's weaker than computer hacking, which is not that strong at all. So it's really, really weak bleed action. So you need that basic bleed to keep up. But as the logic, when you look at the deck, you don't have that many modifiers. Or you have 4 in 65, which is a decent amount. But one could easily see oneself playing 6 or 7 bleed modifiers, because you have dominate on a lot of the guys, but you'd rather rely on bleeds for 2, 3, and 4 consistently heavy every turn, rather than having these huge hits for 8 that you can see in some Arika decks or similar decks.
Yeah.
So keep a constant but high pressure on your prey, and by doing this in the long run, that makes you less vulnerable to a prey playing bounce. Because each bounce will be less efficient than if you bled for shitloads with every action.
Yeah, and of course, I mean, there's kind of a lot of obfuscate in this deck, right?
Yeah.
Not that much.
Well,
10 cards. It's not few either, but it's...
Yeah. I think considering how much you like rely on high caps, it's more than enough.
But yeah.
Well, that's of course meta-dependent. I'm gonna talk out of the Örebro meta. That would be fine. Maybe not in some other meta.
Yeah, because you do a lot of actions. You have 8 flurries and then the political action, so it's not that. Whatever. Okay, so what is like the main weakness of the deck, Adam?
I think that's also what Isaac said about it doesn't bleed a lot. So, as a pool damage focused deck, it doesn't actually outright kill that many preys fast. So you can't just like hurry and oust with this deck. It's gonna take its time. And if that prey is, say, a girl's deck, which builds up really, like, the build-up element is a really big part of the deck, you won't be able to kill it fast. So that's like a weakness, as well as, obviously, it's a choice that Benoit has made when he built this deck, but it could be a weakness in some metas.
Isaac, do you see any other weaknesses?
No, it's actually the perfect deck.
What? You're incredibly dependent on actually getting your flurry of actions through. And this might not seem like a huge problem, but usually you try to have a friendly relationship with your Grand Prey, Grand Predator or Predator when it comes to bounced bleeds. That you're like, okay, we'll take this, I'll just hit you for one, you hit me for one, and then you just leave it be. So you don't have to waste any stealth cards damaging your Grand Prey unnecessarily. But with this particular deck, most of the time you really need the flurry of actions to go through.
Yeah.
So you can end up in a situation where you need to use your stealth to get an action through, because your Grand Prey maybe not that keen on getting full damage. And this ends up... For one, you get bad blood on the table, which is really bad for you in your situation. Cross table, like, get angry with you. But you lose stealth cards doing stuff cross table when you might be in a situation where you need them for your prey. So I think that might be an issue, really. Go on.
Like a little bit like Kindred Spirits deck, but with more to lose than just one pool.
Yeah, in Kindred Spirits, it's really not a problem. You're just, okay, yeah. I'm locked, whatever, let's go on.
The best thing, no, I really need the pool. I have to.
I really need the pool. I'm going to play this card.
Yeah.
Because this is, the deck gets to be a little bit backwards, because most of the time you try to safety up first. First do your superior mind, first do your banishment, first do your bloat action, and then bleed if you have any strength left at the end of the turn. But here you need to start off by punishing your prey, and then possibly punishing your Grand Prey, just because you need to do that banishment, the action afterwards.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah. Because I think a big part of how you deal with a situation where your prey can bounce you and force you into bleeding your prey, or Grand Prey, sorry, is the banishments. Yeah. And then it's really backwards, because you actually want to banish their bouncer, but you can't because you need to bleed first. Do you guys think the reason for the Veil of Legions is to... avoid bad blood with Grand Prey, because then you can bleed with stealth inadvertently. You can like blame Veil of Legions for stealth.
No,
because the Veil of Legions is kind of a weird fit, I think.
Yeah,
but that might be the reason. I don't know.
It might be. For me, I'm with you.
That's a little bit too smart, Dala.
No, it's not.
Well, people think like this when they build decks. They're gonna be smart.
Yeah, I think that might be the reason, because I'm a bit baffled by the Veil of Legions. Like, in essence, in this deck, Veil of Legions says pay one pool for one stealth, which seems a bit costly.
pay because, one pool?
Yeah, you have villain. So yeah. Each blood you pay should have been a pool in your pool for another minion.
Yeah.
Yeah, I can see the logic behind playing Vader Legions, but I don't agree really. I think it's too.
It is really, really costly. It has to be like a good reason for it. It can't just be the stealth or. It's card efficient stealth though. You can get 4 stealth from one card. So
yeah, that was what I was thinking about.
That's the other thing I could think about.
Yeah. On the other hand, it's a little bit backwards because this is a high cap deck, and then you usually rely on high amount of stealth, then Elder Impersonation to force your way through with one or two or maybe three cards, and do it on the one minion and try to get the most out of that one minion. But the Allegiance is more horde bleeding. Yeah, it's weird, but it's smart in a way.
Yeah. Yeah, cool. So the main strength then, Adam.
It's kind of I'm not sure how to describe it. Unstoppable would be the word I was trying to say, but I'm not sure if that describes it accurately. But it just does its thing, and its thing is kind of powerful. You bleed for lots, and you play banishment with 11 caps, and I think that pretty much sums up what makes it win, because banishment is really, really powerful, obviously. And
you talk a lot about banishments. There are only two in the deck.
Yeah, but maybe you only need two to get the game win.
The thing is, with Mistress Fanchon's special, if you need the two early on, you will get the two early on.
Okay.
And Vitus is a short game. There's very few actions, there's very few turns. Two banishments are detrimental.
Yeah, two banishments is easily two game wins. And I think if you've gotten two game wins... Oh, sorry, not game wins, obviously. Victory points. If you've gotten two victory points, you're pretty much there for the entire game win.
Yeah.
So I think banishment is like one of the key elements of this deck. You just remove a key defensive vampire, then you oust your prey.
You make it sound so easy.
Well, the few times I've seen this deck been played, it's kind of magic how it works. You don't really follow when it ousts. It just kind of does its thing, and there's no like critical point where the oust is certain. It just kind of happens eventually.
But is this medium bleeds every single turn, high pressure, and after that there comes some other really nasty action, like a vote or some kind.
So
it's a really strong deck, I feel. But it's also really ridiculous because you have three inner circles and you multi-act with them. It's not easy getting a situation where you have three inner circles, not every game in play, but you could have. At least you have three available to you, and they can multi-act, all of them. I can't think of any other... you can play like Arika, Stanislava and Gwendolyn and multi-act with them, but that's really awkward.
I think the most relevant comparison would be the Obfuscate Ventress deck. Actually,
yeah, but they're not ICs.
They're not ICs, but they can bleed with Govern and then Freak Drive. So they get the same kind of plus bleed, but their cards cost a lot. The actual, like the Govern bleed, if you want to bleed for three, they cost one, and then Freak Drive cost one. So it's a two blood cost instead of Flare Action, which is zero blood cost. So it's more explosive. You kind of have to oust really, really fast with the Obfuscate Ventress. This deck doesn't bank on ousting really, really quickly. The low cost of the card gives it like a lot of freedom.
Yeah, but you would think that as we said, a deck with three multi-acting inner circles sounds like the deck of doom, and it would be so explosive and really fuck up a table and be but this seems like it's there. It's not really high pressure. Not really a deck. If I sit down at a table and see this deck, it's not like seeing a Rika deck or seeing a War Ghoul deck. It's just, it does a thing.
it's several things that Arika and Wargoals have been around for a really long time, so they have a history and a, like a place in the collective consciousness of the Vitas community, like fear these. So this is kind of new. That's the one thing. But the other thing is that it doesn't rely on government conditioning. When you see government conditioning, your heart stops and you get really anxious.
Yeah.
Here with this deck, more or less every table you will have two inner circles and one of the other guys and Enkel Kogan table, so that's 6, 7, 8, 9 basic table bleed.
Yeah.
And then you know that they do multi-act and they have obfuscate, so you'll most probably get their bleeds through as well. And then you have you neatly get obedience in this deck, so you can end up staying untapped with Flare of Action to be able to defend yourself against rushes with obedience and the two majesties. So it's really seeing these vampires and Flare of Action is like genius, really is.
Yeah, and the majesty and the obedience, as you said, it really fits in nicely. I would have gone like it's meta choice, baby, but I would have gone with more majesties, I believe.
Mistress does not have presence.
Okay.
So, like, well. And Adana does not have dominate. I think that's the reason why they're both in the deck.
Okay. Well, that seems more appropriate then. Okay, so quickly, if you meet this deck, how would you play against it, Adam?
It's kind of good to mind numb. if you have the card on hand, obviously. I don't know. Other than that, it's just, I feel like it's slow and it takes it. It's like a stable stealthy deck. And it's not fast enough that it can deal with high pressure. So make sure you get the room to be aggressive against it. And if this deck is your prey, that means that you need to back out your predator. And if this deck is your predator, it means you need to like heavily back out it. But I feel like if you just overload it early, it doesn't have the strength to recuperate. It'll have one less minion, or simply die if it tries to get the third minion.
Yeah. Isaac?
Yeah, I think that's more or less it's a strong deck, but as long as you yourself play strong decks and play well, you will be on par with this deck. But as long as you face something or you see that the table going, that you have some decks on the table which are bad or not good enough, then you will get a really table balance will be really weird. And this deck will end up in a situation which is very beneficial. Because if you have a subpar deck, you can't really do anything about this. So you need to keep that in mind. I don't know, like, if you start off with Pentex on your hand, give it to this deck, it loses at two turns, and that's probably the only thing that you need to do.
Yeah,
exactly.
It's the same with the Mind Numb. If you do one Mind Numb to this deck, it will probably be that one turn behind, and you probably don't have to care about it for the rest of the game.
Is there any reason why you should, I'm going to try and block every single floor of action bleed? Or is it the stealth situation, Isaac?
If you are playing block the flare of action. There's really no point in letting them play the flare of action, get that stuff through, and then let them do a political action, which has a basic stealth, and not it's not a D action. So if you play an Auspex block deck, block flare of action.
Yeah.
And I think that ties in with the overloading part as well, because if it has to play all its stealth, even if it gets the actions through, it has to play all the stealth and it gets all the action cards, which it probably will play as well. It's gonna clog on the monsters.
Yeah.
So that's a way to overload it if you're playing a defensive Auspex deck as well. Yeah. 22 monsters and 65 is easily cloggable if you're forced to play too many cards early.
Okay, cool. After the break, we are going to talk a little bit about the unnamed and Flora of Action, and then later on, Isaac and Adam are going to give us their best draft tips. So stay tuned, you awesome live viewer, and the rest of you on the internet. Watch out for part 2. See you.